starting my discussion for sympathetic nervous system from catecholamines. Okay, so if you want to know about the introduction or for anatomy of sympathetic nervous system, then please you can check out my older videos, or else I'll provide the link for that introduction in the description box. Okay, so starting with catecholamines, few examples of catecholamines are dopamine, epinephrine, and norepinephrine. So these three examples, dopamine, epinephrine, and norepinephrine, these are considered to be endogenous catecholamines. Endogenous catecholamines means these are synthesized inside our body. Okay. So apart from endogenous catecholamines, we have got one more example, that is isoprenaline, also known as isoproterenol. Okay, isoprenaline is also a catecholamine, but it is not an endogenous catecholamine. Whereas dopamine, epinephrine, and norepinephrine, these are endogenous catecholamines. Okay, now I am saying catecholamines, so quickly we'll check out the chemistry of catecholamines. Okay, so catechol ring is somewhat like this. You might be knowing this ring structure. Yes, this is benzene ring. 1, 2. Okay, I'll start. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. 6-membered benzene ring. Okay. So to this benzene ring, if you give hydroxylation at 2 position, suppose this is position number 3 and this is 4, now we call it as dihydroxybenzene, which is also known as catechol. Okay, so this is our catechol. But what we want? We want catechol amines, means we need to add amino group also. So very simple, NH2. This is amine group, this is catechol group, and this is amine group. And we need to link these two things, catechol and amine, we need to link. So these are interconnected by CH2. What is this? This is ethyl. Okay. So we have formed catechol ethyl amine. Okay, that means catechol and amine are interconnected, or they are bridged together via ethyl. This compound is known as catechol ethyl amine, or simply you can say catecholamines. So what I have given the examples, dopamine, epinephrine, norepinephrine, and isoprenaline, all these compounds contain the basic nucleus of catecholamines, and some alteration will produce either dopamine or epinephrine or norepinephrine or isoprenaline. Okay, so this is the basic structure of catecholamines. So next we'll see about the synthesis, like how these catecholamines are being synthesized inside our body. As I have told you, these first three compounds, dopamine, epinephrine, and norepinephrine, these three are endogenous catecholamines. Okay, these are being synthesized inside our body, and they are very much required for a normal functioning of our body. But the thing is, we cannot consume these catecholamines orally. Okay, so first of all, we'll see what will happen if we consume it orally. Suppose this is our GI tract. Okay, and suppose somewhere here is our catecholamine benzene ring with 2 hydroxylation, ethyl group, and then our amine group, that is catecholamine. The very first problem encountered by these catecholamines are they cannot cross this GI biological membrane. You know what is the reason behind it? The reason is these catecholamines are highly polar compound, and polar compound, they cannot cross the biological membrane easily. So the very first problem faced by catecholamine when they are taken by an external route is they cannot cross the biological membrane and they are unable to enter inside our blood circulation. Some of these catecholamines have crossed the biological membrane, on the lining of this GI tract we have got few cutters of this catecholamines. Okay, so those cutters are nothing but the enzymes. Okay, there are few enzymes which are present in the lining of your GI tract. They are not only present in the lining of your GIT tract, but also they are present in the liver and in various other tissues. These two important enzymes that will inhibit the catecholamines are, first of all, catechol-O-methyl transferase, abbreviated as COMT, and the second enzyme is monoamino oxidase. Okay, so let us see what these enzymes will do one by one. Okay, first of all, I'll write the structure of catecholamine and then we'll see how these two enzymes will destroy the catecholamine. Okay, benzene ring with hydroxylation at third and fourth position is catechol. Then this is our ethyl group, and lastly we have got amine group. Okay, so this is our catecholamine. Now first we'll check out the thing which is done by our enzyme monoamino oxidase. See, monoamino oxidase, these are the enzymes that will cause oxidation of monoamine. What is meant by monoamine? Monoamine means these are those amino acids, means these are those compounds which are containing single amino acid, or you can say these are derived from the compounds that have a single amino acid. So our catecholamine is a kind of a monoamine. Okay, so what this enzyme will do to this monoamine, it will produce oxidation. Okay, so what it will do, it will do oxidation of this compound. Okay, suppose this is our enzyme monoamino oxidase. So what this enzyme will do, it will just clip off this amino group. It will just cut the amino group and remove it. Okay, suppose from this catecholamine the amino group has been removed, then will this catecholamine be a catecholamine? No, isn't it? For a catecholamine to be itself, it requires the amino group. But this amino group has been removed by the enzyme monoamino oxidase, and it will inhibit this compound, this catecholamine. Okay, so in this manner, this monoamino oxidase will inhibit or it will destroy the catecholamine. Okay, so this monoamino oxidase will be present in the lining of your GIT as well as in the liver. Okay, so this is how the monoamino oxidase will inhibit the catecholamine. It will just cleave off the amino group. It will produce oxidative destruction of this catecholamine. Okay, so this is done by monoamino oxidase. Now we'll check out the second enzyme, that is catechol O methyl transferase, that what exactly it do. The name only suggests catechol, this is the catechol ring, O ortho, this is the ortho position, methyl transferase, it will transfer a methyl group. Okay, so basically what this enzyme will do, the function is only said by the name itself, isn't it? Suppose this is the enzyme, and what this enzyme will do, it will transfer a methyl group. It will start hammering a methyl group on the ortho position. So what will happen, this hydrogen atom will be removed and it will be replaced by CH3. Okay, so it won't be a catechol ring anymore, isn't it? To become a catechol, there should be hydroxylation at third and fourth position. But what is happening over here, the hydrogen atom has been removed and it has been replaced by methyl group by this enzyme, and in this manner it will destroy the catecholamine. Okay, so we have got two important destroyers, these important enzymes that will inhibit the catecholamine: monoamino oxidase and catechol O methyl transferase. Monoamino oxidase, it will be clipping off this amino group. It will be producing oxidative deamination of the catecholamine. Whereas our second enzyme, that is catechol O methyl transferase, it will be it will be pushing a methyl group on the ortho position of the catechol ring, and by this manner it will be inhibiting this catecholamine structure. Okay, so we have got two important enzymes which are present in the lining of our GI tract, and because of these two enzymes, whatever we are taking the catecholamines and little bit amount whatever is getting absorbed or getting crossing this biological membrane, these two enzymes will be destroying it. Okay, so for this reason we cannot consume catecholamine from external use source, and therefore it is very much important for the synthesis of the catecholamine. Okay, so now we'll see the synthesis of catecholamines. Okay, so now we'll check out the synthesis of catecholamines. Synthesis. For synthesis, the basic requirement is a kind of amino acid which we are getting from our normal diet, and we have got two important amino acids. The first one is phenylalanine and the second one is tyrosine. Okay, so I'll write the structure of both phenylalanine and tyrosine over here. First of all, CH2CHCOOH and over here NH2. So this is the structure of phenylalanine. Okay, next I'll write the structure of tyrosine, which is almost same. Just there will be an extra hydroxylation, that's it. Same here, an OH group that becomes tyrosine. Isn't both the structure similar, means almost similar to catecholamine, isn't it? So these two are the structure of phenylalanine and tyrosine. Now we'll check out what will happen. So suppose this is our GI tract. From our normal diet we are taking both phenylalanine as well as your tyrosine. Okay, suppose this is your phenylalanine and this is tyrosine. Okay, and suppose here is your liver. Okay, in the liver, phenylalanine will be moving inside the liver, and inside the liver, phenylalanine is getting converted into tyrosine, and the enzyme which is required for converting phenylalanine into tyrosine is, yes, what might be the name of the enzyme? See, the basic difference, there is an enzyme over here which is converting phenylalanine into tyrosine. What might be the name of the enzyme? That enzyme is causing hydroxylation of the phenylalanine. So obviously the name of the enzyme will be, yes, phenylalanine hydroxylase. Okay, so the name of the compound is, sorry, the enzyme is phenylalanine hydroxylase, since it is causing hydroxylation of the phenylalanine. Okay, so basically what is happening over here, whatever phenylalanine we have consumed, that phenylalanine is moving to the liver. In the liver there is an enzyme known as phenylalanine hydroxylase that is converting phenylalanine into tyrosine. Okay, and next this tyrosine is then moving inside the blood circulation. Okay, now along with phenylalanine, even we have consumed tyrosine also. So this tyrosine, it will directly enter into the blood circulation. Okay, so we actually require tyrosine. Tyrosine is the actual raw material from which the initiation of the synthesis of your catecholamine will take place. Okay, so either you consume tyrosine as such, or else you consume an amino acid that is phenylalanine. Phenylalanine, it will be eventually getting converted into tyrosine and entering into the blood circulation. Or else if you consume tyrosine as such, it will be from the GI tract, it will be directly entering into your blood circulation. So the very most important thing we require is your tyrosine. Okay, so from tyrosine only there will be initiation of the synthesis of your catecholamines. Okay, now it has entered, we have phenyl, sorry, we have tyrosine in our blood now. Now what's next? Where should this tyrosine go? Okay, now this tyrosine should move to those cells which are involved in the synthesis of your catecholamine. Okay, now from blood vessel, it should go to those areas which are involved in the synthesis of catecholamine. Now the next question is, what are the cells which are involved in the synthesis of catecholamines, where actually the synthesis of this dopamine, epinephrine and norepinephrine takes place? Okay, the answer is, see, you know, we have got several neurons. We have got dopaminergic neuron. Yes. What are the neurotransmitters present in the dopaminergic neuron? Obviously, dopamine. So, dopaminergic neuron is the area where dopamine is being synthesized. And dopamine is nothing but your catecholamine. So, you can think, you can assume that tyrosine can move to the dopaminergic neuron. Similarly, we have got other catecholamines like epinephrine. Epinephrine is mainly synthesized inside the adrenergic neurons. Similarly, we have got noradrenergic neurons. Okay. Noradrenergic neurons, we are calling them noradrenergic neurons because the synthesis, storage and release of noradrenaline occurs in this neuron. Similarly, adrenergic neurons means these are the neurons which are involved in the synthesis, storage and release of adrenaline. Similarly, dopaminergic neuron means these are the neurons which are involved in the synthesis, storage and release of the dopamine. And all these, dopamine, adrenaline and noradrenaline, all these three things are nothing but your catecholamines. Okay, so whatever tyrosine is getting absorbed in the blood circulation, eventually they are supposed to move to these areas, these cells, because these are the cells which are involved in the synthesis of catecholamines. Now, apart from these three neurons, where else might be the area where catecholamine synthesis may take place? Now, the answer is, suppose this is your brain and I am talking about the sympathetic system. Suppose this is your preganglionic neuron and this one is your postganglionic neuron and this might be your effector organ. Now in the sympathetic system, the preganglionic neuron have got acetylcholine, a neurotransmitter, whereas the postganglionic neuron have got norepinephrine as the neurotransmitter. So here also synthesis of norepinephrine is being taking place. So you can also expect that tyrosine, apart from moving to these areas, it should also move to this neuron also. This neuron is sympathetic postganglionic neuron. Okay, so this is the another area where synthesis of catecholamine may take place. Sympathetic post ganglionic neurons. Okay, now where else will you think that this catecholamine will be present? Yes, you might be knowing your adrenal medulla. Suppose this is your kidney and above the kidney will be your adrenal glands, outside adrenal cortex and inside adrenal medulla. So under stressful condition, the adrenal medulla will be start producing epinephrine. In the adrenal medulla, we have got very important cells known as the chromaffin cells. Chromaffin cells. So basically in these chromaffin cells, the synthesis of epinephrine take place. Okay, so same thing, this is a preganglionic neuron over here ending up in the adrenal medulla. And this preganglionic neuron, what kind of neurotransmitter it will be releasing? Yes, that is acetylcholine. Okay, so the chromaffin cells under stressful condition, it will start producing nearly 80% of epinephrine and nearly 20% of norepinephrine. So it is also a site where synthesis of your catecholamine take place. Okay, so these all the are the areas where synthesis of catecholamine takes place. So whatever tyrosine or phenylalanine after getting converted into tyrosine, this tyrosine after appearing into the blood circulation, you can expect that this tyrosine may moving either in the dopaminergic neuron, adrenergic neuron, or noradrenergic neuron, or sympathetic postganglionic neuron, or to the chromaffin cells. Okay. So this is the fate of the tyrosine. To these areas, the tyrosine will be moving. Okay. After moving into these areas, the actual synthesis of catecholamine will take place. Okay. Now we'll take an example of any of these neurons. Suppose we are taking about dopaminergic neuron. Okay. So suppose this is your dopaminergic neuron, a cell body, axon, and an axonal and terminal. So basically, in the entire structure of your neuron, this is the area where synthesis of catecholamine is been carried out. Therefore, whatever tyrosine is present in your blood circulation, in the neuron, it will be entering into the end terminal, the axonal end terminal of any of these neurons. Okay. Now we'll see that what exactly the synthesis step takes place inside this axon and terminal. So suppose this is your dopaminergic neuron, the cell body, axon, and axon and terminal I am making little bit bigger out of proportion so that we can understand clearly that what all steps are being taking place inside here in the axonal and terminal. Okay. So regarding the biochemistry, I'll be writing in this page. So till now, what has been taking place? Phenylalanine is converted into tyrosine, and tyrosine is now present inside our blood circulation. Okay. Now the next step is the tyrosine, which is present inside our blood circulation. Suppose this is any of your blood circulation, and here is your tyrosine. How this tyrosine will be moving inside this axonal end terminal? Okay, so for crossing this axonal membrane, we have got a transporter over here. And this transporter is a kind of sodium dependent transporter. Why this sodium dependent transporter? The tyrosine will be getting collected inside the axonal end terminal. Okay. Now after moving inside, the tyrosine will meet with some kind of enzyme, and that enzyme, what it will do, it will convert tyrosine into a compound known as DOPA. So first of all, we'll see the structure of DOPA, and after looking at the structure of DOPA, we can suggest the name of the enzyme. Okay. So this tyrosine is getting converted into DOPA. So the structure of DOPA is somewhat like this. Everything is almost same, but the difference is we have got hydroxylation at third position also. In tyrosine, there was only one hydroxylation, but in DOPA, this is DOPA, okay. In DOPA, there is one more increased hydroxylation. So what might be the name of the enzyme which is producing a hydroxylation on the tyrosine? Yes, the name of the enzyme will be hydroxylase, and since it is hydroxylating tyrosine, the name will be tyrosine hydroxylase. Okay, so tyrosine hydroxylase is the enzyme which is present inside the axonal end terminal. Okay, tyrosine hydroxylase. So what it will do? It will cause hydroxylation of the tyrosine on the third position. Now if you see the structure of this DOPA, it is almost similar to phenylalanine. Okay, it is almost similar to phenylalanine. Just difference is we have got two hydroxylation in DOPA, but there is no hydroxylation on the phenylalanine. So if you say DOPA is almost like dihydroxyphenylalanine. Okay, so it is nothing but dihydroxyphenylalanine, which is abbreviated as DOPA, dihydroxyphenylalanine, which is nothing but DOPA. Okay, so what is happening over here? Inside the axon and terminal, the tyrosine will meet an enzyme, that is tyrosine hydroxylase. It shall get hydroxylated and gets converted into dihydroxyphenylalanine, also known as DOPA. Next, this DOPA will meet an another enzyme that will convert it into dopamine. Okay, now let us see the structure of this dopamine and then you can suggest the name of the enzyme. Okay, so this DOPA is converted into dopamine and the structure of dopamine is somewhat like this. CH2, CH2, NH2. This is dopamine. Now, what difference can you see in the structure of DOPA and dopamine? Yes, here there was COOH. Here there is no COOH. So, what is happening over here? There is a removal of COO, or you can say CO2, and the H will come back over here. So, we have got CH2. So what this enzyme is causing? Yes, it is causing decarboxylation. So it is a kind of decarboxylase enzyme. And to which structure it is producing decarboxylation? Yes, to DOPA. So the name of the enzyme is DOPA decarboxylase. Okay, so DOPA decarboxylase will convert DOPA into dopamine. Okay, now after dopamine is been synthesized, what will happen next? You know, in this axonal end terminal there will be various cell organelles and one among them is your mitochondria. Okay, and on the surface of the mitochondria there will be an enzyme known as monoamino oxidase. Okay, now what this monoamino oxidase will be doing to the dopamine? Yes, you know, this monoamino oxidase will cause oxidative deamination of this dopamine. It will try to destroy this dopamine by clipping off this amino group. Okay, so what this dopamine will do? It will cause deamination. It will produce oxidative deamination of this dopamine and it will destroy. So after the synthesis of dopamine, the next step is we need to protect this dopamine. So for protecting dopamine, it is getting transferred into a vesicle. Okay, the dopamine is getting transferred inside a vesicle. Okay, inside this vesicle, large number of dopamine is getting stored. Why it is getting stored inside the vesicle means because it needs to get protected from the enzyme monoamino oxidase. Now, this is not that simple. There is a transporter sitting over here. So what this transporter will do? This transporter will transport the dopamine into the vesicle. Okay, without this transporter, it cannot be getting transported inside the vesicle. Now, the name of this transporter is VMAT2 transporter. VMAT2 stands for vesicle monoamine transporter type 2. Okay, so this VMAT2 transporter is present over here in the vesicle and whatever dopamine is been synthesized, it will try to take them and move it inside to the vesicle. Okay, now suppose this neuron is a kind of dopaminergic neuron, means this will be the end of the step. Afterwards, whenever action potential occurs, there will be a release of the dopamine into the synapse. But instead, if this neuron is a kind of noradrenergic neuron means we need to convert dopamine into noradrenaline. Okay, so the enzyme required for the synthesis of noradrenaline is present inside this vesicle only. So next we'll see the structure of noradrenaline and you can suggest the name of the enzyme. Okay, so dopamine getting converted into noradrenaline and the structure of noradrenaline is somewhat like this. Okay, now we have framed a catechol ring and few alteration will produce norepinephrine as well as epinephrine. Okay, now you know this is a 6-membered ring. These two carbon atom, this is alpha carbon atom and this is beta carbon atom. Nothing happens to alpha carbon atom, but on the beta carbon atom there will be hydroxylation. Okay, so the enzyme which is required for converting dopamine into norepinephrine is a kind of hydroxylation kind of enzyme. So the name of the enzyme will be hydroxylase, where it is producing hydroxylation on the beta position of the dopamine. So the name of the enzyme is dopamine beta hydroxylase. Okay, so dopamine beta hydroxylase is the enzyme that will convert dopamine into norepinephrine. And in which means where this enzyme is present? This enzyme is present in the vesicles of noradrenergic neuron. Okay, please do not get confused. Okay, if this neuron is a kind of dopaminergic neuron, means the synthesis has been completed of the dopamine. But instead, if this neuron is a kind of noradrenergic neuron, means it needs to get converted into noradrenaline. So inside this vesicle there will be dopamine beta hydroxylase enzyme that will go on converting dopamine into norepinephrine. Okay, so suppose this is the vesicle for dopamine. Now suppose if in case it is a kind of noradrenergic neuron, then the vesicles will be containing norepinephrine. Along with that, the enzyme dopamine beta hydroxylase, plus it is also having ATP and also a protein. The name of the protein is chromogranin. Okay, so the vesicles, this vesicle is mainly present in the dopaminergic neuron. Okay, this vesicle is present in the dopaminergic neuron, and this kind of vesicle you will find in the noradrenergic neuron. Okay, so if it is a kind of noradrenergic neuron, means the vesicle contains norepinephrine along with the enzyme dopamine beta hydroxylase, plus there will be ATP and chromogranin. Okay, now suppose this is a kind of adrenergic neuron, or your chromaffin cells of your adrenal medulla, then there should be an enzyme that will convert norepinephrine into epinephrine, isn't it? So very fastly we'll check out the structure of epinephrine, which is quite very much simple. Okay, a catechol. On the beta position there will be hydroxylation CH2, and the difference is over here H, and there will be a methyl group. Okay, so methylation on the amino group will produce epinephrine. This is epinephrine. Okay, so the basic difference between norepinephrine and epinephrine is, in epinephrine there will be methylation on the amino group. Okay, so what might be the name of the enzyme? This enzyme is transferring a methyl group. So it is a kind of methyl transferase. And where it is transferring? On the N terminal of the amino group. So the name of the enzyme is N-methyl transferase. So where do you expect this enzyme? This enzyme is expected in the adrenergic neuron as well as in the chromaffin cells of the adrenal medulla. Okay, So here it will, this vesicle will now be containing your adrenaline or epinephrine, whatever you say. Okay. Adrenaline. Now, we'll start from the beginning. We had consumed from our diet phenylalanine or tyrosine. Okay, so tyrosine will move to the liver. Here it will meet with an enzyme that is phenylalanine hydroxylase, and it will get converted into tyrosine. And whatever tyrosine we are consuming in the GIT, everything will be moving into your blood circulation. From the blood circulation, this tyrosine is expected to move to those cells which are involved in the synthesis of catecholamines. So those structures are dopaminergic neuron, adrenergic neuron, noradrenergic neuron, sympathetic postganglionic neuron, or your chromaffin cells. Okay, now suppose it is a kind of dopaminergic neuron, means how many enzymes do you expect over here? Yes, in case of dopaminergic neuron, we require tyrosine hydroxylase, we require DOPA decarboxylase. That's it, two enzymes. So if it is a kind of dopaminergic neuron, we have got just two enzymes over here. Okay, first enzyme will be converting tyrosine into DOPA, and second one DOPA into dopamine. That's it. Now suppose it is a kind of, we'll talk about noradrenergic neuron first. If it is a kind of noradrenergic neuron, means how many enzymes it require? First of all, tyrosine into DOPA, this is first enzyme. Next, DOPA to dopamine, DOPA decarboxylase, second enzyme. And the third enzyme will be, yes, this one, dopamine beta hydroxylase. So three enzymes, so you can write 2 plus 1. So three enzymes are be present in the noradrenergic neuron, as well as in the sympathetic postganglionic neurons also, because most of the sympathetic postganglionic neuron contains norepinephrine or noradrenaline. So here also you expect three enzymes. Next, if you are talking about adrenergic neurons, then how many enzymes you require? Firstly, the enzyme required for converting tyrosine into DOPA, second enzyme for converting DOPA into dopamine, third enzyme for converting dopamine into norepinephrine, and fourth enzyme for converting norepinephrine into epinephrine. So we require four enzymes. So you can write 2 plus 1 plus 1. So four enzyme is required for the synthesis of adrenaline, or you can say adrenergic neurons contains four enzyme. Similarly, the chromaffin cells of your adrenal medulla also contains four enzymes. Okay, so I believe you people are not confusing between the synthesis. Like in dopamine, means we require just synthesis of dopamine. In dopaminergic neuron, you cannot synthesize adrenaline or noradrenaline. Okay, in dopaminergic neuron, after the synthesis of dopamine, it will be stored over there. That's it. In the noradrenergic neuron, the synthesis of noradrenaline takes place, which takes place inside the storage vesicle only. Similarly, in the adrenergic neuron, the synthesis of adrenaline occurs in the storage vesicle only. In the storage vesicle, dopamine is converted into norepinephrine, and then norepinephrine is converted into epinephrine. Okay, so this is about the synthesis of your catecholamines. So far we have studied about the synthesis and storage. The next step will be the release of these catecholamines, the release of these neurotransmitters. So release occurs when there is a flow of action potential. Okay, depolarization followed by repolarization. The wave of action potential should be flowing over here. So what happens when action potential occurs? Yes, there will be depolarization, because of which lots and lots of sodium ion will be moving inside. Okay, and because of this sodium ion moving inside, it will take the membrane potential from the resting membrane potential to the depolarization. Okay, and once depolarization occurs, the sodium channel will be closed, and there will be opening of calcium as well as the potassium channel. Okay, so there will be influx of calcium ion, and there will be outflux of your potassium ion. Now we are concerned with calcium ion over here. The calcium influx is very much required for the release of this neurotransmitter, for this catecholamines. See, what will be happening over here is, there will be a protein present on the membrane of this vesicle. Similarly, there is a protein which is present on this axonal membrane. ओके एंड इन प्रेजेंस ऑफ दिस कैल्शियम आयोन दिस प्रोटीन ऑफ द वेसिकल विल फ्यूज विद द प्रोटीन ऑफ द एक्सॉन एंड फ्यूजन ऑफ दिस विल कॉज डिजॉल्विंग ऑफ द मेम्ब्रेन. ओके सो द मेम्ब्रेन ऑफ योर वेसिकल विल बिकम लाइक दिस. ओके दिस पार्ट विल बी गेटिंग डिजॉल्व. ओके सिमिलरली अ पार्ट ऑफ दिस एक्सॉनल मेम्ब्रेन विल गेट डिजॉल्व एंड वाया exocytosis these catecholamines will be released outside the neuron or you can say it will be released in the synapse. Okay now this is a preganglionic or presynaptic membrane you can say and this one is your postsynaptic membrane. On the postsynaptic membrane you expect receptors over here. So whatever catecholamines are there either it may be dopamine or norepinephrine or epinephrine, it should interact with these receptors and after interacting with the receptors, action will be produced. Okay, now next what will happen? Suppose these are interacting with the receptors and the number of catecholamines are very high. Suppose this is a dopamine and large amount of dopamine is present in the synapse and they are in queue, like when their turn will come and when they will interact with the receptor, they are standing in queue. And when they are standing in queue, means still they have not interacted with the receptor. So what will happen? Here outside, a very important or rather you can say a very dangerous enzyme will be there. The name is catechol-O-methyltransferase. And you people might be knowing what this enzyme will be doing. This enzyme will be hammering the methyl group on the catechol ring of your catecholamine and from this enzyme we need to protect our catecholamines. So how can we give protection to these catecholamines? Yes, we have got a mechanism known as reuptake mechanism. So what will happen over here is whatever the catecholamine is been released, it is expected to interact with the receptor. But if the number of receptor are less and the number of catecholamines are more, that means there is chance that this enzyme will attack to those free staying catecholamines in the synapse. So we have got a mechanism known as the reuptake mechanism that will reuptake these catecholamines back into the neuron. Either it may be dopamine or norepinephrine or epinephrine. Whatever catecholamines are present in the synapse which are still not interacted with the receptor, they are taken back into the neuron. This mechanism is known as reuptake mechanism and this transporter is known as norepinephrine transporter, NET. Okay, do not get confused that it is norepinephrine transporter, how it can cause reuptake of dopamine and epinephrine. See, it is nothing like that. Only the name is norepinephrine transporter, but it will cause reuptake of dopamine, norepinephrine as well as of epinephrine. Okay, so by this way we can protect our catecholamine by the attack of COMT, that is catechol-O-methyltransferase enzyme. Now after moving inside, one more enzyme is there, that is monoamino oxidase, and we need to give protection to this catecholamine from monoamino oxidase also. So what will happen? Yes, again we have got the same transporter, that is VMAT transporter, and we will take this back into the vesicle. Okay, if it is a dopaminergic neuron, there will be, you know, taken back into this vesicle. If it is a kind of noradrenergic neuron, it will be taken up like that. Okay, so in all vesicles we have got this VMAT2 transmitter. Okay, so we need to give protection to these catecholamines from both COMT as well as from monoamino oxidase. So for protecting from monoamino oxidase, we will, you know, collect these catecholamines inside the vesicles, and to give protection from the COMT enzyme, we will reuptake it back into the neuron. Okay, COMT is mainly present in the synapse and monoamino oxidase will be present inside the axonal and terminal. So this is regarding the release and the reuptake. Now we'll see some of the inhibitors that will inhibit these processes. Okay, so very first inhibitor we have got over here. There is a drug known as alpha methyl para tyrosine. So what this drug will do, you know, When you consume this drug, this enzyme, this tyrosine hydroxylase enzyme will get confused that whether it need to interact with tyrosine or whether it need to interact with alpha-methyl-paratyrosine. So in this confusion, if it interacts with alpha-methyl-paratyrosine, there won't be the synthesis of DOPA. Okay, so in this manner we can inhibit the synthesis in the very first step as such. See, this the first step, the conversion of tyrosine into DOPA, it is a kind of rate limiting step. Rate limiting step means it is a kind of very slow step. So in this slow step as such, we can inhibit the synthesis of catecholamine. Now, under what circumstances we can use this alpha methyl paratyrosine means? There is a condition known as pheochromocytoma. Okay, so pheochromocytoma is a kind of tumor where large amount of this catecholamine are being synthesized inside our body, and there is more than normal amount of catecholamine synthesized, and anything beyond normal is not good, isn't it? So we need to limit, we need to control the synthesis of this catecholamine. So we can limit it with the help of this drug, that is alpha methyl paratyrosine. It is mainly used in the treatment of pheochromocytoma. Okay, so alpha methyl paratyrosine will inhibit the conversion of tyrosine into DOPA. Next, we have got another inhibitor. The name of this inhibitor is alpha-methyl-DOPA. Alpha-methyl-DOPA. So what this alpha-methyl-DOPA will do? It will confuse this DOPA decarboxylase to whether it should act on DOPA or whether it should act on alpha-methyl-DOPA. So this alpha-methyl-DOPA will inhibit the conversion of DOPA into dopamine. Okay, now the third inhibitor is the inhibitor that will inhibit the transfer, the movement of dopamine into the vesicle. So the name of this drug is reserpine. So what reserpine will do? This reserpine will block, it will inhibit this transporter. This VMAT2 transporter is getting inhibited. When this transporter is getting inhibited, the dopamine will not move inside the vesicle. And this dopamine is very much prone to be getting attacked by the enzyme monoamino oxidase. Okay. Now our next inhibitor is the inhibitor of the reuptake. There is a drug that will inhibit the reuptake, and the name of that drug is cocaine. Okay. So what cocaine will do? The cocaine will inhibit the reuptake of this catecholamine back into the neuron. So what will happen? More amount of catecholamine will stay in the synapse and more likely to be getting attacked by the COMT enzyme. So we have got 1, 2, 3 and 4. 4 inhibitors. First one is the alpha methyl para tyrosine that will inhibit the conversion of tyrosine into DOPA. Second inhibitor is alpha methyl DOPA. It will inhibit the conversion of DOPA into dopamine. The third inhibitor is the reserpine. The reserpine will inhibit the movement of the dopamine into inside the vesicle. And the fourth inhibitor is cocaine. What cocaine will do? The cocaine will inhibit the reuptake of the catecholamine by inhibiting this NET transporters.